So my name is Lucia Petti. I'm the coordinator of this European project, which is sponsorizing funding this school. And I come from Institute of Applied Sciences and Intelligent Systems, Caianiello, of the National Council of Research in Italy. The title of my lecture is Man-made cutting-edge materials for light control and manipulation at the nanoscale. So let's start with a very brief introduction of ourselves. This is part of our research institute. We are located in south of Italy, in Pozzuoli, which is a place very close to Naples area. My group focuses on a study, the realization and the optical diagnostic techniques of nanostructured composite materials and metamaterials for photonics, optoelectronics, and biosensing. And most of these activities are performed in four different labs, which are the nanocomposites and soft metal lab, the smart materials lab, which was funded thanks to the funds of this European project of Alscom, and it's a chemistry lab. Then the electron beam lithography lab, and the integrated optic lab, which is devoted to characterization of materials and nanomaterials. So my group works basically on nanotechnology and materials for composites devices. What we do is to simulate and design, to fabricate and to characterize plasmonic and polymeric nanostructured materials in order to realize different kinds of applications. For example, we are working on food safety and biological applications, employing techniques like localized surface plasmon resonances and CERS biosensing. But these topics will be dealt a lot tomorrow by Dr. Massimo Rippa. We have been working a lot on lighting applications, for example, employing our nanomaterials for enhancing OLED emission. And this work has been done in a very strong collaboration with Giuseppe Nin and his group at Enea. And another application of our materials is in liquid crystal and, of course, azopolymers. And for example, we have been working in the realization of devices, photosensitive liquid crystals with photo quasi crystals, which can be driven by an electro signal or optically, but we will see later. Okay, the outline of my talk. My talk is divided in three parts. I will start speaking about cutting edge materials, but many things have already been said by Bogdan and his group. I will describe the kind of technology, of top-down technology, that we employ in order to make our nanostructures. And I will give you some idea of applications of these nanostructured materials. Let's start with cutting-edge materials. Let's start trying to understand what is a metamaterial. Professor Stan already introduced the metamaterials, but let's say something from a different side. If I consider the interaction of light with a nanomaterial, I can consider this line, and I can consider this ratio, where A is a lattice parameter and can be, for example, the distance between two very close structures, or can be also the period of my nanostructure. In this case, here you see holes with a specific geometric pattern on holes in a gold material. And lambda is the wavelength of incident light. Now, if the lattice parameter is smaller, very, very smaller than the incident wavelength, we have that the kind of physics that is employed is basically based on an effective medium description using Maxwell equations. While if you have a situation in which your lattice parameter, so your nanostructure, has a lattice parameter, so a size which is comparable to the wavelength of the incident light, what happens is that the structure dominates. And so in this case, the kind of properties of the physics, which is at the base, is determined by properties of diffraction and interference. Last case is when we have lattice parameters which can be bigger, much bigger than the incident wavelengths. And in this case, what we have is that the properties of interaction of the material are described using what in physics we call geometrical optics and ray tracing. But let's come to the definition. This is the one of the definitions that we can give of a metamaterial. Metamaterial is an engineered. Be very careful to this light. This is a good suggestion from me. A metamaterial is an engineered composite that exhibits superior properties not observed in nature, not observed in the constituent materials. And the superior properties that you have in a metamaterial are a result of the engineered construction of the metamaterial itself. And this definition has been done by DARPA in 2008. So a metamaterial is expected to display one or more properties which are rather qualitatively extraordinary compared to the ordinary properties of the constituent elements. So in other words, we get to a sort of paradox when we face metamaterials. The paradox is that we have that the whole is more than the sum of its parts. Well, everybody probably saw Harry Potter's films. Now, as a matter of fact, that is not only a film. Because a metamaterial can give you the possibility of what is named the cloaking effect, that is invisibility, and this is, of course, this is not, this is just artificial, but the concept is the same, the concept of invisibility. Well, what is also interesting here is that metamaterials have been discovered not so far in time. And this is a very special picture, because in this picture, this was a school which was done some years ago in Hong Kong. And during this school, there were attending this school, lecturing in this school, all people, most of the people who invented metamaterials, people like Eli Yablonovich, John Pendry, Nader Engheta, David Smith, Yuri Kischer, Ortwin Hess, and Roberto Merlin. So this is interesting because show you that, you know, we are not talking about something of the very old past. Inventors of these materials are still live people. This is an example of some metamaterials. These are scanning electron microscopies of different metamaterials. What we have is a periodic repetition, in this case, of gold nanopillars, in this case, of triangular nanoprisms, with a size of size of 170 nanometers. While in these other three cases, we have not periodic repetition, we have not, let's say, photonic crystals or common metamaterials, but we have what we call quasi-periodic crystals. We will discuss about them later, with different properties. We have a sort of octagonal nanorods, with, well, these are cylinders, gold cylinders, with a diameter of 100 nanometer. Then we have two Mohs. Two Mohs is the kind of repetition, the kind of nanopattern morphology of this structure. And these also are nanocylinders. And again, they have a diameter, each of them has a diameter of 100 nanometers. And in this case, we have the same kind of structure here, same kind of two Mohs quasi-crystal structure. But in this case, instead of having cylinders, pillars, cylindrical pillars, we have square nanorods of 100 nanometer side size. Well, photonic crystals have already been described by the previous talk, and it has already been said that, for example, when we see a butterfly and we have a look at the wings of butterfly, you see, we have this specific iridescence aspect. As a matter of fact, if we do a scanning electron microscopy of the wings of these butterflies, we will realize that at a very, very small scale, at a nanoscale, this is made of a periodic structure. And that is, this is a photonic crystal. Well, properties of the photonic crystals, more important properties is that they have lattice constants, which are comparable to light wavelengths of incident light. These materials have properties which are governed by diffraction of a periodic structure. And also they can exhibit band gap for photons. So this means that there are specific wavelengths of light that cannot be propagated in such medium. Another interesting category of, let's say, photonic metamaterials is, for example, photonic quasicrystals. These are not periodic structures. We have examples of photonic quasicrystals, for example, in these glasses, Windows glasses. In a tomb, we see a sort of a periodic structure, a periodic tracery, in 1197. We have in 1974 studies from Penrose, the scientist Penrose, and he studied a specific set of tiles we see here for covering a surface. And also in this case, this kind of tiling is what we call a quasicrystal structure. And finally, in 1984, there was the official discovering by Shepman from Technion Israeli University, the official discovery of quasicrystals. Again, we have some examples also in nature of quasicrystals. Here we have very interesting tiling, interesting pattern in algae systems. This is also a quasi-crystal structure, natural structure in sunflowers. And again, also in the wings of this insect, if we have a look, a very close look with a scanning electron microscopy, we will see that, as a matter of fact, the composition of these wings is basically made of a sort of let's say quasi periodic repetition. Well, just to give some more technical definition, photonic crystal is characterized by being a periodic structure. Periodic and periodicity is the periodicity also of the index contrast. So we have different layers, each layer with a specific refractive index. And we have, in this case, an alternate of two different refractive index. This kind of refractive index modulation, periodic refractive index modulation, gives rise to properties of the photonic crystals that we already mentioned. That is, inhibition, for example, of photon propagation, what we call stop band, that is, when light is propagating, specific wavelengths of light are propagating through a photonic crystal, they can be diffracted, they can be stopped, they can be inhibited. We can have enhanced density of states at band edges, or we can have photon localization. The first time that also we had some studies on these materials, some studies have been done by Brillouin in 1946, studies on wave propagation in periodic structures. And finally, from 1946, we arrived to 1987, when Eli Yablonovich and John officially discovered photonic crystals. We already saw before that photonic crystals can be 1D materials if they are periodic in one direction, can be 2D if they are periodic in two directions, or can be 3D structures if they are periodic in three directions. Well, just definition of what is the difference again between photonic crystals and photonic quasicrystals. Photonic quasicrystals are metacrystals with a quasi-periodic dielectric function. And the fact that they are characterized by a quasi-periodic dielectric function is the origin of the properties of these materials, because they exhibit fascinating optical properties, which lie somewhere between properties of disordered structures and periodic structures. So this causes properties such as orientational orders, which are associated to rotational symmetries of arbitrary high order. We can have long-range quasi-periodic translational order in such materials. And we can also have band gaps with a very lower index contrast. And this is different if we make a comparison with the case of periodic geometries. What we see here are different scanning, we have scanning electron microscopies of three different kinds of photonic quasicrystals. And what you see here, and this is the setup that we employed, is the interaction that we have with a laser light, a green laser light. So diffraction effects, when you have a laser light, like what I'm using here as a pointer, a laser light which is going through these materials. So diffraction effects are characterized by different kinds of photonic quasicrystals. So in this case, we have an octagonal structure, and as a matter of fact, you have 8 diffraction points in when light passes through this material. In this case, you have a dodecagonal quasicrystal structure, and as a matter of fact, when you cross with light such a nanostructure, you will have 12 diffraction points. Again, in this case, you have, again, scanning electron microscopies of different nanostructures. On the bottom, well, the three bottom image, the three top images describes three quasicrystals named octagonal, tumors, and dodecagonal, while the three bottom images are periodic nanostructures named because of their specific properties, enantiomers inverted, achiral octuples, and gammadions. All this, in this case, you have gold nanopillars, while in these three cases, the other three cases are nanoholes in gold. Again, if you analyze these structures using a laser source, with like a green laser source, what you will find going through these materials are again 8 diffraction points, or in a tumors, this kind of very nice pattern. And this is a kind of analysis that is named far field diffraction. What happens is if instead of using laser light, like a green laser light or monochromatic laser light, what happens is if we use a white laser. In this case, we have very fascinating images in, crossing these three different quasi crystals, which are considered colorimetric fingerprints. Why? The question is, why do we use this kind of analysis? Because, for example, we want to see if the kind of nanostructure that we have fabricated, if this is good. And this is a very non-invasive way to have an idea of how good has been our fabrication process in the nanostructure fabricated. Top down, you saw different nanostructures. All of them have been fabricated in my lab. And the technique that we employed is electron beam lithography. And this is the system that we employed, which is in my institute. The technique is a specialized technique, electron beam lithography, which is very interesting in order to create extremely fine patterns, which can be used for example, integrated circuits. How does it work? It consists of scanning a beam of electrons across the surface, and this surface is covered with a resist film, which is sensitive to those electrons. What happens in the interaction between the electrons and the resist film is that you are depositing energy in a desired pattern in the polymeric, in the resist film. Well, typical characteristics of this technique is the very, very high resolution that we can have, few nanometers, and the fact that it is a very flexible technique. So you can use, you can employ a variety of materials, and you can use, it depends on you, because you make, you design an infinite number of patterns. Okay, this was our system, and it was when it was mounted the first time. Electron beam lithography technique is very interesting for different applications, for example, mask fabrication, which can be then employed by optical lithography. It's very good for direct writing and for the manufacture of very small volume specialty products, such, for example, optical waveguides, or can be also employed, for example, for the realization of nano devices, but we will see something. Have a very good look at this slide suggestion. Electron beam lithography can be compared to optical lithography. Now, characteristics of lithography is optical or electron beam lithography is how small can be an isolated feature, how the smallest isolated feature which can be repeatedly printed in a photolithographic process. Well, this measure, the measure of such a smallest feature, is expressed by this relation. You have resolution, and resolution is proportional to the wavelength. Now, if we consider the process, optical lithography fabrication process, you have that, you have in this table represented the different wavelengths that you can employ in optical lithography, which can go from example from 436, probably down to less than 193 nanometers. These wavelengths of incident light will give you the possibility to have structures, nanostructures, going from 450 nanometers down to 90 or even less, but almost 90 or 80 nanometers. So this means that the limit of resolution of optical lithography is the light wavelength. While in electron beam lithography, you have electrons, so you have different, okay, the source is not light, but are electrons. And in this case, the only limitation that you can have in the building nanostructure is being the beam size, which is nanometers. Okay, the top-down approach that we employ is a standard fabrication process where you have that you spin coat initially a resist, which is electron sensitive. Then you have electron beam lithography patterning and developing. And so you have your holes design pattern in your polymer. Then you have the deposition of gold. You can do it by different techniques. In this case, we did it by electron beam evaporation with Enea institution. And at this step, what you have is something like this. That is, you have a kind of nanostructure which is made of nano holes in a gold film. Or you can go further. So you can go through a chemical process, which is a lift-off process, by which you remove part of the resist, which is down. And by removing this resist, you get to the final nanostructure, which is made only of pillars, gold pillars. And the final kind of nanostructure that you might have is gold nanopillars without any polymer left. And here you have an example of, here you have this kind of structure. So these are nanoholes on gold. And the fact that you see different colors is due to the fact that here you have different kind of nanostructures with different kind of diffractive properties shown. So they correspond to different colors. Just a very short definition. When you work in nanostructures fabrication with electron beam lithography, you go through two different kind of resists, positive and negative. Positive resists work basically by polymer chain scission, that is the kind of the exposed part of the polymer becomes more soluble. While with negative resists, you have a different mechanism. You have it usually, this is based on cross-linking of cross-linking between the polymer chains. So this means that when you use materials which are negative resists, you have that the exposed polymer becomes insoluble. And this is the schematic that you already saw before. This is an example of positive resist where you have an induced chain scission of a positive PMMA resist, polymethyl methacrylate resist. And this is what happens when you expose such material to an electron beam lithography process. We do this kind of work in different labs in my institute. So we have a soft matter and nanocomposite lab where we prepare the resist, we spin the polymer. We have a nanofabrication lab where we use electron beam lithography, and so we create the nanostructuring. And then we have an integrated optic lab where we characterize the kind of nanostructures realized. Again, you have the process schematized in this way. The kind of resist that we use is commercially known as ZEP 520. First step in our process, fabrication process, is resist spin coating. We spin coat a uniform film, polymer film. Then we have electron beam lithography nanopatterning. By chemical development, we have holes in the polymer. Then we have pattern transfer by metal deposition, so we have deposition of metal. By lift-off process, we get rid of part of the polymer. And finally, at the end of our process, we have a nanostructure, which is a metal nanostructure. And meta nanostructure means what we call a plasmonic nanostructure. Now, we have then to characterize our nanostructures. So one of the kind of characterization that we employ is UVV spectroscopy. This will be described better tomorrow by Dr. Massimo Rippa, who, as a matter of fact, did this kind of homemade UVV spectroscopy system. But the principle working, this has been made using different parts of optical components, also some old parts of old microscopes used to create a new system. What you do basically is to propagate light through focusing light through an objective on our nanostructure, and then you collect light by a fiber and you send the optical signal to a spectrophotometer. So what you have, and you see here, is the kind of signal is the plasmonic resonance, due plasmonic resonance, which is typical of a specific nanostructure that you have fabricated. And this is as it works, and as I already described, it's a very fast analysis, and the response, the final response, is this kind of curve. And I don't want to say more, I will say more later. What can happen? So we have a plasmonic resonance. Plasmonic resonance is typical of a specific nanostructure with specific lattice parameter. But if I change the parameters, I can change the plasmonic. Okay, this is the important message that I would like to transmit. So it depends from us. I mean, we can fabricate our nanostructure changing our parameters as we like, and the fact that we change the parameters means that we change the resonance of our nanostructure. And we'll see why this is important. Another kind of nanostructure characterization, very important, we'll see why later, it's amplified Raman spectroscopy, which is usually known, well known as CERS technique. Works in this way, we have a laser source, in this case of 785 nanometers. Light is coupled through a fiber and an objective onto our nanostructure. You have then the collected signal is sent to a Raman spectrophotometer. Collected signal is Raman scattered signal. This is analyzed through a Raman spectrophotometer, and the kind of response that you collect is this one, that is a sort of spectra. And the analysis has been, is very, very fast, because this is very important, is done in a few seconds. Applications. Applications of photonic crystals and photonic quasicrystals are many. We can use these materials for outcoupling as outcouplers of light, for lasing effects, for controlling light propagation, for optical nanobiosensing, for light emitting devices. Well, let's try to, I will give you some information about what we do with these materials. So what we do, for example, is making biosensors. Now, principle of optical nanobiosensing. A biosensor, let's say that it's made of two different parts. Usually it's done basically done on the biorecognition layer and the transducer. On the biorecognition layer, you attach the different target analytes, and then through the transducer, you convert the information that you get from the capture of the analytes of the biorecognition layer into a signal. Now, analytes can be different substances, like, you know, ions, biomolecules, virus, bacteria, cells, and so on. And transducers can be of different kind, basically based on material properties. For example, it can be electrical properties, optical properties, magnetic, mass, thermodynamical. So many, many, many of them. In our case, we work with optical sensing. So the kind of nanobiosensors that we make in my labs are sensors based on refractive index based detection, or sensors based on amplified Raman cells. Well, biorecognition layer can be made, for example, of antibodies or, for example, of phages, which are immobilized on this part on a part of your sensor. While the transducer that we employ in our nanobiosensing are plasmonics nanostructures, that is gold nanostructures. So we make plasmonic nanostructured sensors. These are characterized by having plasmonic resonances and near field distribution, which affect the main important properties of sensors, which are sensitivity, limit of detection, and reproducibility. But at the same time, we have that the size, shape, and symmetries of the nanostructures are the elements that affect the plasmonic resonances. So this means that when we make a nanostructure, we can play with these parameters, with size, shape, and symmetries, to work on the to improve the performances of our nanobiosensors. Again, when we can say that a biosensor is a good biosensor? Well, we have specific requirements. These requirements, for example, are that we need highly sensitive biosensors, very uniform biosensor, and reproducible biosensors. These three properties are governed by the kind of nanomaterials that you are employing and by the nanofabrication process. While the specificity and selectivity properties of nanobiosensors mostly depend on the kind of functionalization that you adopt, so how good you functionalize your nanostructure. Functionalize means how good you attach your capture elements, that is your phages, for example, or antibodies. So if you want to develop a new diagnostic test, what are the very important key issues are rapidity, sensitivity, and specificity. Well, we work with two different approaches in biosensing: localized surface plasmon resonance biosensing, where what happens in this kind of approach? You have that position and height of a resonance peak depends on the size, shape, and composition of the nanostructure on one side, and on the local dielectric environment. So what happens is that you have that your biomolecular recognition elements, that is receptors, are functionalized to plasmonic resonance devices. And after this functionalization, you have an analyte can be attached. Now, you start from your nanostructure, which is bare, and you have this kind of signal, for example. Then you functionalize, for example, with some your nanostructure through this chemical approach. You attach your antibodies, and you have the same signal analyzing through UV this spectroscopy. But what happens here is that when you add an analyte, when you attach here an analyte, that is the antigen, what happens is that this curve shifts And from this shift, you have an information. You are detecting what has been put on your nano sensor. So in this kind of approach, you have that plasmonic nanoparticles are the transducers that convert changes in the local refractive index into spectral shifts of the localized of the resonance of the localized surface plasmon resonance. Now, with this approach, you can have a very high sensitivity, but you can combine this approach also with Raman spectroscopy, because with Raman spectroscopy, with amplified Raman spectroscopy, you can have a specificity too. So CERS, amplified Raman spectroscopy, gives you the possibility to identify probe molecules. The other approach is CERS biosensing. CERS biosensing means that when you use a plasmonic nanostructures, you have that from Raman scattering, you go to enhanced Raman scattering. So what happens is that your nanostructure acts as your gold nanostructure, because this is a plasmonic nanostructure substrate. This works as an amplifier. It's something that it amplifies signals, and this means that you combine the high molecular specificity of the technique of Raman spectroscopy with a very high sensitivity of your plasmonic nanostructure. Why do you do that? Because in this way, you have a plasmon resonance leads to local field enhancement near the surface. So you have that the absorbed molecules see an increased field. You can have a Raman signal enhancement up to 10, 15, but this depends on the kind of the local geometry of your nanostructure. You have a sort of molecular fingerprinting, because each molecule have a specific fingerprint. So you have unique vibrational spectra which can distinguish molecules. So finally, what happens is that you go to femtomolar and also beyond femtomolar. So it means that you can have a detection of single molecule. With these materials, you can control light and manipulation at a nanoscale. This is another example. In this case, here you have a nanostructure. This has been prepared on the top of a glass substrate. What happens is that if you go on one side with an incident white light source, which is very broad, what happens is that when light goes through your glass substrate, when it crosses the nanostructure, it sees the nanostructure, light is diffracted, light is extracted. But what is interesting is that the kind of extraction is not broad, but is very, 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 very sharp. Very sharp. And so what you have is that you have an uncoupling from nanostructures with a very selective diffraction peaks. So you have extracted modes, and you see here the difference. Well, you can play with materials. Now I will go a little bit faster. Well, you can play with materials for different reasons. Different reasons can be the main reason is that you want to improve functionality. You want to achieve new functionality in materials. So you want to expand your applicability. And also in this case, you can use periodic or periodic photonic crystals combined, for example, to nanorods with specific properties. Why? Because these materials can give you the possibility to have, for example, light emitting applications such as lasing. These materials can have nanorods, I will show you immediately after, can present, for example, nanorods, strong and tunable light emission, and can be highly fluorescent, can show then linearly polarized emission. Example, I can combine my polymer with nanorods. Nanorods have these properties. For example, with UV light, they are photoluminescent. So I can make a nanocomposite material, starting from the electron-sensitive polymer, adding dopants. What I have is a nanocomposite, so a uniform nanocomposite material. You see this effect because we are using light from one side of the glass, and you can nanostructure this specific nanocomposite. And when you nanostructure this nanocomposite, you have such effect. So you have nanostructure that can be used in order to select, to have an effect of wavelength selective diffraction with active photonic structures. And you can pattern whatever you like. This is the kind of setup that we have employed, but this has already been shown, a kind of extraction that you can have. This is an example. You can dope your nanostructure with, for example, liquid crystal materials with photosensitive material. You can realize with materials, you see, you can realize a photoquasicrystal and the photosensitive liquid crystal cell structure working as a single photonic device. What does it mean? It means that when you have light propagating such a structure, light can be extracted, but light is extracted. If I apply a field, I can change the kind of extraction. I can enhance the extraction, or I can also apply a light, getting the same result. So I can amplify the properties of my device using, for example, liquid crystals. These are just some examples of our other nanostructures with different applications. So just scanning electron microscopy images of chiral metamolecules for quantum information processing. You can see some information, if you like to have them, on this publication. Finally, what we did very close to our project is the nanostructuring of photomobile polymers. We used this sketch, procedure in order to fabricate our final photomobile nanostructured material. And what you have is a very nice photomobile polymer nanostructure with very nice diffraction properties. Why to do that? Because this can be used, for example, for biosensing purposes. And again, you have here some references that you can use. All these activities done in collaboration with different institutions like Wrocław University of Science and Technology in Poland, like the Superior Institute of Health in Italy, in terms of food safety nutrition, with the Department of Food Safety, Nutrition and Veterinary Public Health Department. Biosensing activities is done with Zooprophylactic Institute of South Italy in the frame of different projects, and also with China, with Photonics Institute of Ningbo and Franz Kashan. And finally, I thank you for your attention. I hope that it was clear enough. And anyway, we will put all the slides of our presentations on our website. So you will have a possibility to have a look at them at a second time if you want. If you need some more information, you can be in touch with me at my email addresses. And thank you for your attention.